In March 2020, the COVID-19 has been severely spreading throughout the United States, forcing many states to shut down businesses and other activities in order to flatten the curve. Some of the individuals that are struggling by this is an employee of a cafe franchise, a barber of a small barbershop, and a co-founder of the Broken Bad Brewery, leaving them to adjust and adapt to this pandemic. Before that, many of these individuals and other people never thought it would turn out like this.
When I first heard about it, and it had yet to come to the United States, I really didn't think a whole lot about it. There was a couple people that I knew that were really concerned about it, but it didn't seem real because it was on another continent.
A little misleading there back in February. We thought, you know, it was across seas and in a different country, and we pretty much assumed it wasn't something that we were going to have to deal with. And then all of a sudden March happened, and our outlook on the whole thing changed pretty rapidly.
The COVID-19 said 2 months, closed the business, no business. I'm sit my home for my family, thinking for about nothing for business. No help, no, I can't pay anything for the business.
Since the spread of the virus, many workplaces and businesses had to close down. Some lay off their employees. Some had to adjust to keep the shop open.
Right around St. Patrick's Day, the world sort of started on fire, and we had to shut everything down. So it caught us off guard a little bit, for sure. Anybody that was bartending or working on the service side, we weren't allowed to open our tap room, so those jobs were completely eliminated by government ordinance. It's the first weekend in April to basically pivoting to to-go operations within about a week. So we went in a very different direction than we planned on going.
The first customer called me for the appointment the first. Okay, I cleaned the chair, cleaned the my slippers, cleaned everything. If he don't have mask, I give him the mask free. Right now I want more up for my business, but it's not easy for this. It's hard because the people not coming, all of them.
Some employees choose not to work for the safety of their health.
Yeah, I stopped going to work in mid-March because of concerns about the spread of COVID. I have asthma, and so I'm at high risk for catching and being severely affected by COVID.
In April, the federal government has issued a stimulus relief package for Americans and small businesses to help with those who are struggling to maintain finances in the rapid changes in the economy.
I did receive my stimulus check. It was direct deposited to me. Well, I've been pretty lucky to be able to, receive some money to help me stay afloat, to be able to keep paying rent, to be able to keep, you know, paying for energy and food and stuff.
We kept a very close eye on some of the government offerings with, the IRS and SBA and some of the government bailout options that were there for small businesses, and we're able to take advantage of some of those to just keep us afloat while we were being forced to shut down.
The government is try help me, but it's not enough for the business, for the bill, for the help for my rent house.
While people and businesses are enduring this crisis, some are still hopeful for things to get better.
Being safe and careful while we do it, those are things that are really important to us, and we're just happy to sort of weather the storm, and we're going to keep doing our part to get this virus taken care of and get back to some sense of normalcy, hopefully in the next year or two.
I'm gonna drink until I forget my name.
We are currently very behind because there's a lot of things going wrong. We are missing a guest co-host and a guest, which fill up a lot of time, and they're really good for transitions. So therefore, we have to scramble during the hour and a half here.
planned as well as well you got it and stuff. We're gonna pretty much see what we have in the script that we can use, trim any of the fat that we can't use, and go live at 10:30. So.
Coming up on MATC Now.
MATC's magazine show, short of showing off the classes, the programs, the people that make MATC great. Everything from events to things going on inside of the college, outside the college, how it benefits the community. Everything we document. The second year students at the TV video program go out, shoot their packages, edit it, and then we do it live in the studio.
You'll have it. Control to tape.
It's a little like more confined than just like field directing or directing anything else where you have time to put something together. I think it's just like any live show. It's putting all the different pieces and making them all fit in the time slot you have and making them as good as possible, which is super difficult because you have so many factors that go into it with the timing, with other people, with your talent, with the script, with the packages you're rolling in, the camera operators and all that stuff. There's nothing you can fix because it's all like happening in front of you and you have to make decisions as it happens. And that's the most difficult part is what is the right thing to do at that specific moment.
So if I adjust the clip way down and such and, you know, green it up, you can see the box.
I mean, it's basically having everything organized and ready to go so that the director can show up, lead the team, and do their job today. And I think that's what's most important. I think Patrick's done a good job prepping everyone today. It seems like he had scripts out early and positions ready to go. So I think that's about the best that we can ask for.
Gabby, point there. We have whoever designed camera 3.
The floor director is the link between the director and the floor. They are the ones that interpret the director's, what the director is trying to accomplish for the talent and the guests and so on, as well as making sure that everyone is on set and where they need to be when they need to be there, and understands where they need to go and when they need to get there. So for example, if we have any guests on the show, the floor director is going to be likely going to be the one to make sure that they are where they need to be and that they're comfortable, as well as giving cues and making sure that the talent is understanding what's going on and where they need to be.
Getting ready to go to the in-building cosmetology department where they have barbershop.
Package producer has to create a story, so whether it be alumni or faculty or events or program of the week, they're creating a story. They find the topic, they research it, they get all the contacts, shoot it, edit it, all that good stuff, and get it ready for air.
No audio today.
The audio person has to come very early, make sure all the mics and the wires and the fallback and the IFB, and if I'm talking technical, how the communication between the floor and the, like, the control room. Make sure the director can talk to them. If they send music, they know there, if there's a feedback. Make sure all the mics are working, and that's pretty much about it.
What are you gonna be doing today?
Camera operator.
Camera operator needs to make sure they can get the host, the guests. They have to make sure they leave the proper lead room, proper headroom, stay in focus, and make sure you follow them, keep their reactions in frame. Otherwise, it'll look kind of weird if you cut off someone's head.
My job as prompter is just to like run, is to just like put script on copy, and the talent reads it from their cameras, basically. That's all it is.
So we got here, Michelle, that's it. And then it's the, what I do as the CG operator is cue up lower thirds and the graphics that are going to be in the show.
And my job as executive producer is just to make sure that all systems are go. So help, you know, create the set with them, find the host for them, make sure that, you know, everyone knows what they want to do, and make sure that we know the workflow of how to accomplish the vision. So it's a bunch of paperwork, a bunch of behind the scenes stuff, but eventually it gets us to the final show.
Tape is good, we're clear.
Hi guys, I'm student producer Elise File, and this is another episode of Hidden Gem KE. We're here at Milwaukee Institution Miller & Campbell Costume Service in Walker's Point. Miller & Campbell began almost 100 years ago as Dave Miller Costume Shop, and they've been helping customers with costuming ever since. Owner Suzanne Campbell started working at the shop back in 1979 while she was in college. She stayed on and eventually bought the business. They're the go-to costume service for area schools, theater groups, and even businesses across the country. Drag performers come here for the stage makeup. They've got high-quality makeup to achieve any kind of look or character. And for the rest of us who aren't actors or drag queens, Miller & Campbell can still help. If you have a specific idea, say Darth Vader, or if you still need an idea for Halloween, Miller & Campbell is ready and willing to help make it happen. Just come prepared to be creative, and they can help transform you into whoever or whatever you want to be. That's it for today's Gem KE. I'm Elise File. Thanks for watching.
Well, we've had to make some changes, obviously, by moving many of our lectures online and having some of our lab classes move to simulation. This summer was a bit difficult as we had to make up some clinical experience in the hospitals. We don't want to put our students at risk by sending them to facilities, and they weren't ready to have us yet as they were dealing with the COVID outbreak. They are working with our students now, and we're caught up, so hopefully we will graduate a new large group of healthcare workers in December, ready to join the front lines in this fight against COVID.
That is cool. So have you seen a change in the enrollment at all?
Actually, no. If anything, our enrollment is doing really well for new students coming in this fall and starting in their programs in January. There's a lot of interest in healthcare now, and there's a lot of need, so jobs are very much available across all levels of healthcare.
So what would you say has been the biggest barrier or challenge during everything that has happened?
Well, I think one thing that people need to realize about healthcare workers is that we're the types that go toward the fire. You know, when there's an issue, we sign up for this. We know what the risks are, and this is a choice that we make. So I wouldn't necessarily call it a barrier, but just understanding that our students are the best prepared. They know how to keep themselves safe, and they are willing to sign up for that risk to serve the community and to advance their careers.
That is cool. That is really amazing. Thank you so much for joining us and sharing your expertise today. You and the faculty really do so much for the school, don't you, Eric?
I think that we are a wonderful program and a great career choice for all the students out there, and we look forward to continue to serve the community and the school.
Hello, I'm student producer John Carlo Rosilio, and you're watching another Hidden Gem KE. We're here at the Schlitz Audubon Nature Center in Bayside. This 185-acre nature preserve originally started as a forested area inhabited by Native Americans. Today, it's a great place to get away from the noise and stress of everyday life through nature.
The Schlitz has a variety of trails, forests, and wetlands for you to hike through, even a 60-foot tower to see autumn in its true beauty.
Not only does this place have gorgeous scenery, it has birds of prey, too.
This is a great place for kids to get introduced to nature. Even my buddy Skywalker here gets in on the fun.
Birds aren't the only wildlife you'll see here. On the Mystery Boardwalk Trail, you'll see frogs, muskrats, turtles, and more. Well, I think that's it for my day at the forest. I'll be here checking out the best view of Lake Michigan. Anyways, this has been another Hidden Gem KE.
Everyone, student producer Gabrielle Nasby here, and this is a Hidden Gem KE.
Today we are here at Three Bridges Park. This park features a 2-mile walking trail, river access for fishing, canoeing, and many different community gardens.
This park opened in the summer of 2013 and is located between 27th and 37th Street, a 24-acre oasis urban in the Menominee River Valley.
Back in the 1960s, this particular area used to be filled with more man-made barriers like train tracks and freeways before the area got redesigned to a better area where the community can get together. The park is connected with the Menominee River Valley that has a rich narrative of bridging the past to the future, north to south, and it is located between the Potawatomi Hotel Casinos and the Mitchell Park Conservatory.
Well, that's all the time we have for this episode. I'm Gabrielle Nasby, and this has been your Hidden Gem KE. I'm gonna go for a walk.
Today we're going to be doing chicken breast, onions, and bell peppers. So the reason we're using chicken breast is because it is a relatively easy cut of chicken to cook. It's pretty hard to mess it up just because it doesn't have a very high fat content, so it's not as scary to cook. It's something that has a lot of fat, which can tend to like bubble and sizzle in the pan, which can be intimidating for first-time cooks. And it's one of the cheaper cuts of chicken. But it doesn't have very much flavor because of that, so we've marinated ours today. So a marinade is basically just a sort of liquid and spice combination that you will put a meat in and then either refrigerate it or leave it out on your counter, depending on how long you're leaving it. And it just imparts a lot of flavors into the meat. So for our marinade today, we've got a spice blend that's pretty standard for like Tex-Mex food. Our star ingredient for the spices is cumin, which is basically in like every single like Mexican dish. We've got a little bit of chili powder, which adds flavor and heat. So if you like your food spicy, you can add more chili powder. If you're someone who's really not a fan of spicy food, you can use very little. But I would say that you want to use even just a tiny bit, even if you think that you don't like spicy food, just because it adds a lot of flavor as well. After the chili powder, we've got paprika, which adds a little bit of smokiness and also like adds color. So, it, you know, the bright red here is very vibrant and helps the chicken just like get a good like coating on the outside of it. And then we've got garlic powder just for some extra flavor. And then the last spice here is totally optional. This one is crushed pepper flakes. So if you like spicy food, you can definitely put a bunch of that in your marinade. But if you, again, are not a fan, you can just completely omit that one. It's not like the chili powder where it's like essential to the flavors. And we've got onions. We already cut these up ahead of time just because you want them to be very thinly sliced. But they're pretty simple. You can use whichever kind of onion you prefer. Today we're using a yellow onion, but if you like the flavors of a white or red onion better, that's totally fine. And then we've got our bell pepper. So we're gonna go right into cutting the bell pepper before we do any of our other ingredients, just because it can be a bit of a complicated vegetable to handle, especially if you're not very experienced in the kitchen. But I'm going to show you a couple things that will make it way easier to manage bell peppers going forward, especially for a recipe like this. So what you're gonna wanna do is take your knife and cut off the top of the pepper. You'll have a little resistance, and that's just from the core in here. And then you will also cut off the bottom. So that'll leave you with sort of a cylinder here that'll stand up on its own, and you'll just take out the core because you do not want all the seeds in there. And then you're just going to make a little split in the side of the pepper, and then you can sort of unfold it here, so that makes it a lot easier to cut into even strips. The one other thing you want to do just before you start cutting is to remove this little bit of flesh here. So the whiter part of the pepper flesh does not have as much flavor in it. It's just sort of tough and fibrous and hard to get through. So it's totally edible. You just really don't want to eat it necessarily. And so we'll cut off our other chunk of that over here too. And then usually what I like to do is then cut it in half, and then you can just sort of stack it so you get pretty uniform slices. And then you'll just take your knife and do just thin little cuts. So the reason you want your onions and peppers thin for this recipe is just so that they will cook up faster. So fajitas are usually something that you don't want to spend a ton of time cooking. They're like, if you want something that's more of a home-cooked meal but you don't have a ton of time, they're a really good choice to go to. All right, so we've got our pepper almost through here. So we're using a red bell pepper here, but typically fajitas will have a green pepper instead. The main difference is that the closer to red the color of a pepper is, the more flavor it has in it and the more spice it has. So a green bell pepper is a lot like sweeter and doesn't have as like potent of a spice to it. But obviously it just depends on, much like the chili flake and the chili powder, how much spice you like in your food. All right, so we've got our peppers ready to go there, so we'll just set those aside with our onions. And we're gonna cook the chicken first, just because it will take a little bit longer to cook than the veggies. So we've also cut the chicken into thin strips, much like the peppers. Again, that's just so that it'll cook faster. And so we've got a pan here, we already preheated this, and we just have a little bit of olive oil in there. And you're just gonna put your chicken in and make sure not to crowd it all in one place, just so that it will cook evenly. All right, so while your chicken is going, if you have a stove with enough burners, you can go ahead and start warming some tortillas. So this is another optional step. If you don't have enough burner space at home to do this, you can totally just omit this. But just toasting the tortillas a little bit on each side just makes the meal a little better, because, you know, the warm tortilla with the warm fajita ingredients just really comes together a lot better. And you don't even need to toast them for very long. Just a few seconds on each side is enough to get a little bit of heat in there. Let's go ahead and turn our chicken around. You can see it's getting a little bit of color on there. So the like charring here, a lot of that comes from our spice blend. Obviously you'll get some color anyway just from the oil, but the spices really help bring out the extra colors in there and make it just look tastier. So we've got our tortillas all set over here. And then we're just gonna take our chicken off the burner and set it aside over here. So I'm draining off a little of the oil with the chicken too, just because with how many spices are in the chicken, the oil has a lot of flavor in it. So if the chicken sits off to the side with that, it'll just absorb even more flavor than from when it was marinating. And then we'll just put our pan back down, and we're going to put a little salt and pepper on our onions and peppers, just so they get a little more flavor. And I'm giving them a little toss just so that they get coated. And then we will just go ahead and put our veggies in the pan. And give them a little bit of a stir around just so they all get some oil. All right, so we've got some that we made ahead of time just because the chicken can take a little bit longer to cook. So we've got our chicken and our peppers and onions here. So you're gonna wanna cook yours at home until you get this sort of like a little bit of translucence on the onions. Go ahead and serve some of that up. Put it in the tortilla with your chicken. And then, so that's the basics of your fajita there. If you wanna add sour cream, hot sauce, anything like that, that's totally up to you. But this is just the basics of the stuff you need to cook for it. And there you go. You've got yourself a tasty fajita. And we'll see you again next week when we'll be making pumpkin bars with James.
Hey guys, student producer Michel Gross with another Hidden Gem KE. What is the relationship between stress, cats, and coffee? Studies show that interacting with cats can reduce stress, anxiety, and potentially helps you sleep better. What if you don't have someone like Hector? No problem, because Katie McHugh formulated an idea to create Sip and Purr, the first coffee bar with cats in the Midwest. Sip and Purr is designed for everyone, cat lovers and cat enthusiasts, especially ones who want to experience what it is like to interact with cats. You can get into the enclosed area or watch through the window while you get tea, coffee, or a cat-themed cocktail. Like this one, this is a Moscow Mule. These beauties will join you as you sip or eat. They have traveled from as far as Qatar, and all the others come from Lakeland Animal Shelter in Wisconsin, where they have lived in an open cat colony, which makes them very, very friendly. Your connection with them may grow as you cuddle, sip, and eat with your new feline friend. You may fall in so much love with them that you will be aching to take them home. This has been another Hidden Gem KE.
Milwaukee is home to many institutions of higher learning. As the fall of the 2020 semester approaches, these campuses have been steadily working to put guidelines in place for learning to occur during this pandemic. Deanna Leedsky, director of the CREATE Institute at the Milwaukee School of Engineering, stresses the importance of the school's responsibility to staff and students and the need to be flexible as we discover more about this virus.
We need to be nimble, right? And I think that's something that we at MSOE shine in is our ability to be flexible and nimble. We're a small private institution, so we can react really quickly when things arise. Right now, the plan is to be prepared for we don't know what's going to happen. So have that backup plan, have your courses prepared to be able to teach online, and be hopeful that students will be able to return in fall and we'll be able to be together in a socially, you know, distance ourselves and in a responsible way, we'll be able to have students on campus.
Ben Dombrowski, chair of the COVID-19 task force at the Milwaukee Institute of Art and Design, addresses a problem all schools face: hands-on learning during this unprecedented time.
We have an amazing set of labs. We have a printmaking lab, a photography lab. We have a space called the 3D lab with, you know, all the wood tools and metalworking and welding and foundry and all those types of things. And a lot of that is based on face-to-face contact. The good news is that there are models for being able to operate safely under those environments. Some of the courses, you know, like our liberal studies courses, some of those that aren't a studio-based course
and we're moving those to online so that we can maximize the amount of square footage that students can have for their studio experience. So those classrooms can now become, say, studios, for instance, or workspaces.
Dr. P. Pamela Holt, Dean of Online Learning at Milwaukee Area Technical College, adds that many schools have the need to accommodate tradition and non-traditional students alike.
Some of our adult learners who are, you know, 40s, 50s, it's a challenge because they didn't plan to learn online. They're not comfortable. They don't feel that that they're getting as much out of it just because of not having that discourse in a classroom. So we try to really mimic that environment and to make sure that there is live interaction, and students, some of them do attend a regular class on a regular day, but it is virtual. So we have those options. We also have 100% online. We have some hybrids and so on, but you know, it's what works for one group of students might not work for another. So you have to keep addressing students where they're at. You cannot apply one method or model across the board.
There are creative ways these schools are going about addressing hands-on learning. The classic idea of hands-on is evolving into an online environment.
We're bringing in guest speakers. I mean, that's one of the advantages of this, right? Is maybe you wouldn't have, as a faculty member, thought to connect with an expert in a certain topic that lives in Seattle because you knew they weren't going to be able to come to your class in person. Now it's a no-brainer to call that individual and say, hey, I'm teaching a class at Milwaukee School of Engineering. Would you like to be a guest lecturer or come and visit my classroom via Teams? Sure, that's an easy thing to set up. So it's, in some ways, it's created distance, but in other ways, it helps you to understand how little distance there is amongst all of us if you just get a little bit innovative in the way that you connect with those around you.
Some schools have used this time as an opportunity to study themselves, looking at how they can better serve their students not only during this time, but beyond.
It's really easy to become complacent, especially at an institution like MIAD where our enrollment has been consistently increasing year upon year. You could understand that there would be a temptation to rest on your laurels. And something like this is a real good wake-up call for the institution to look hard at itself and go, okay, what is the real value that we're contributing to here? And so we've been able to become a little bit more targeted and a little bit more surgical as far as how we're delivering content to our students.
There's an art to moving classes online. Not all students had access to computers at home, and that was a concern moving to an online environment.
We had to consider our student population and unrepresented students where they're attending class here and they might be taking courses online, but they would actually use the on-campus computer. So they had no home computer, so we had to accommodate that. And we did that fairly quickly by reaching out and through some entrepreneurship funds and things like that. And donations, we were able to purchase Chromebooks for some of our students and just give those to them so that they could continue their learning. We're continuing that process for the fall to make sure that our students are equipped to be successful in an online or a hybrid venue.
One unanticipated lesson students will learn during this difficult time is perseverance.
Students are learning that they can cope with challenging situations, and that's a life skill that we all need. And it's not easy to learn that life skill, but this is an opportunity to grow through that and learn from that. And as an individual, as a team, as a cohort of students, and also our faculty and our staff, right? We're learning together as well how to make it through a really tough situation.
Jack-o'-lanterns aren't the only thing you can make out of fall's most fearsome fruit. Pumpkin and its entourage of spices are a delicious way to add a touch of autumn to many classic recipes. Let's head over to the kitchen and see how these fall flavors have inspired our resident baker, Chef James. What you got for us today?
Well, Hannah, I'm baking up some sweet treats and teaching some culinary tricks today. Since it's pumpkin spice season, I'm making a friend's recipe for pumpkin bars that highlight the warm, earthy flavors of the autumn gourd. To keep things simple, I'm starting with a pre-made cake mix and adding in a couple ingredients to really bring the Halloween spirit. So let's start mixing. So what I'm using here is a yellow cake mix that you can find at pretty much any grocery store, but the easiest way to do it is to use just a spice cake mix, because then that's all the dry ingredients you have. But if you can't find it, that's okay. You can do what I'm doing and use a yellow cake mix with some spices of your choice. You can either just find the pumpkin pie spices already mixed, or you can find your own favorite spice mix that you use for pumpkin pies or anything similar. Then we're gonna start adding the wet ingredients. Eggs go in first, they're just so they can just break up the yolks and start mixing. Next up, we're gonna be using mayonnaise. So why mayonnaise? It's a dressing that you wouldn't really think would go in cake, but it is basically just eggs, oil, water, and a couple different things for flavoring. So when you think about it, that's just the wet ingredients of a box cake mix. It's basically like how flour, sugar, and baking powder is all in there. This is all your wet ingredients already pre-mixed. And it's a great way to save a little time and money at the grocery store. Lastly, as we're mixing this together, we're gonna add our pumpkin. That's what gives it its nice orange flavor and makes it pumpkin bars and not pumpkin spice bars, since a lot of pumpkin spice things don't actually have pumpkin in them, just the spices. Now, I'm also going to move to my spatula because the whisk is not really loving how thick the mixture's getting. So we're just gonna mix this until it all mixes together. And then it will be ready to pour. So just make sure all of the ingredients are kind of mixed so the powder isn't everywhere and it's all just a nice consistency. Once you've got it together, making sure you've got the sides, you're ready to pour. So you're gonna have a pan, and it doesn't matter what size or anything, just make sure it's greased. Use a vegetable spray, use a little oil, everything's fine. I like to pour into a pan by just like scraping, making sure I'm getting all of it out of the bowl first before I worry about it getting, you know, all in evenly. Now, once it's get all out of the bowl, put that off to the side. Don't worry if you spill a little, it's all fun. Now you can spread it out from the middle out to the edges, and you can even turn the pan as you do it to really make sure that this can go quick. Once it's all nice and smoothed out, you can be ready to put it into the oven. Now we have our oven at 350 degrees Fahrenheit, and that'll be in there for maybe 20 minutes. But why wait? Since when you want to frost this, you want it to be cool. You don't have to frost it, but I think it's fun, and I personally love the combination of pumpkin and cream cheese. So that's why I'm using cream cheese frosting. It's just like a nice flavor while not being super overly sweet. That's gonna be really similar to putting the batter in, where you just kind of plop some in the middle and spread out from there. And mix, so the cake has to be cool because as you see, it's a little hard to spread, and you don't want the cake to either make it too runny or to just fall apart. So make sure everything's at a good temperature for spreading. All right. And as you go out to the edges, it's just, you want to make sure you get out to the edges so everyone can get an even portion of frosting, because you don't want to get an edge piece that has only a little bit of frosting on it. And honestly, this is a super easy cake recipe that it doesn't even have to be pumpkin. It can be, you can modify box cake mixes to do a lot of different stuff. And it's a really nice way to be able to bake at home without worrying about like having to get a bunch of different ingredients that you might have too much of later and taking up space, and there's just a lot of hassle with it. This way it's a nice, easy, pretty hassle-free way to get a nice sweet treat in your home for the fall. And once you're getting it nice and smoothed out, there you have it. A delectable fall treat. I hope you get a chance to make these for friends, family, or just for yourself as a little personal pick-me-up. And feel free to experiment, like I said, with any of the spices or any varieties to make your own specialty cake mix. We've got this recipe and some other suggestions in the link down below. Until next time, happy fall, y'all.
Thanks, James. After seeing how delicious those look, I definitely have a newfound yet begrudging respect for mayonnaise. You might even call that dressing up.
And this is Michelle Gross.
And we are here in
Las Vegas!
So it's pretty amazing to see all the sights and the lights, and it's pretty exciting to meet industry professionals, people from all sorts of fields, you know, of broadcast, and I'm really excited to see what's going to happen.
This place is huge. Consider the world's largest convention center with almost 2 million square feet of exhibit space.
The NAB show hosts more than 100,000 people this year and more than 1,600 exhibitors that showcases the most amazing products.
Remarkable for myself because I personally have used cameras almost all my life, but actually being able to talk one-on-one with so many people who have explored these cameras has allowed me to expand my own knowledge in a sense that, like, they're helping me troubleshoot things that I would have never even thought to troubleshoot, and vice versa.
And we both got the chance to experience all this.
We invite the top film school and communication schools to bring the best of the best, and they learn from Sony using the equipment that their school has been using, whether it's broadcast cameras, switchers, servers, and they spend time here. And not only do they help Sony because they're an extension of our sales force, but they also get to learn.
It's truly remarkable. I've met some people from Frontline, somebody from a community college. I never thought I'd be able to say something like that. SUNY has definitely opened up doors for me that I didn't know existed. YouTuber to high-end movie producer, NAB has something for everybody.
And don't worry if you couldn't make it this time. This convention is every year.
Hey guys, I'm student producer Alex Mazurek, welcoming you to another Hidden Gem KE. Today I'm here at the Brew House Inn and Suites, located on the corner of 10th and Juno. Inside this beautiful hotel lies over 150 years of history.
See, once upon a time, this building served as the brewery for the Pabst Brewing Company. From around 1844 all the way to 1996, Pabst brewed their famous beer in large copper kettles right here in the heart of Milwaukee. The place was reimagined in 2011 after lying abandoned for almost 20 years, and in 2013 it reopened as the Brew House Inn and Suites.
Now when Gorman and Company turned this into a hotel, they took special care to maintain as much as possible of the history that was here for them already. Those brew kettles I mentioned earlier, they're still here.
Old lumber, vintage stairs, and even a stained glass display of the patron saint of beer all remain from the previous life of the brew house. All coupled with modern rooms and city views that are pretty hard to beat, the brew house makes a great spot that represents Milwaukee's past and its future.
That's all we've got for you today. My name's Alex, and thank you so much for watching another Hidden Gem KE.
You have a passion for saving people's lives and staying healthy? You should join the health department. We ran into a few staff members who could explain some of the changes in the health field.
COVID has really changed how our students are learning. We are doing all of our lectures online and doing Blackboard Collaborate sessions whenever possible. All of our lab and clinicals are actually on campus. I always worry that all of us are protected and making sure that we do not take home COVID from the institution to our families. And so we make sure, again, that they are following those protective equipment, that personal protective equipment, and then just following protocol as far as disinfecting, hand washing, and that sort of thing. Our students also are seeing patients from the outside, so it's not just one-on-one in amongst the students, but they are also seeing patients from off campus. We have so many different programs within the health field. The health care pathway is one of the biggest pathways within the college, and we offer so many different systems or different programs. From associate degree to technical degree to your diplomas, and there is so many different avenues that you can go. You know, if you are not an associate degree type person that you want to get done and get out, you can always go to maybe something that's not exactly in the same realm but within that same field, such as in dentistry. We have dental hygiene, we have dental assisting, and we even have dental lab tech too. Dental lab tech is not part of the healthcare pathway, but there is also a dental lab tech program. Actually, I think that right now is a great time to come into the health field. I know COVID kind of can scare people away a little bit, but when you're talking the healthcare field, you need to know infection control to begin with, and you need to always treat your patients like everybody is infected. And I've lived through the era of starting to work on patients when AIDS came about and all those other infectious diseases. And, you know, actually it's a great time when you have a disease or a virus that's out there to actually get into the field and learn proper infection control right away, because you should be doing those practices whether we have a pandemic or we're in just normal life.
While working in the same field, a teacher and a student perspectives are different. We were able to talk to a student about his studies and current state of the health department.
I definitely like in-person learning more because it's a very hands-on job, and being able to see, you know, people's anatomy in person is a lot different than seeing a picture online, where being able to move them and feel them in person is a lot more beneficial than seeing pictures or someone explaining it. I'm looking to go into CT or MRI because radiography offers a lot of different modalities, but those two are my ones of interest. Doctors that come out to the clinic sites do a really good job at explaining and keeping track of us, and that they really want the best for us, and they always keep note on our progress. So I think that's really good how they do it. I think right now there is a pretty big demand for techs and other healthcare positions, but even bigger locations and more equipment might create even more jobs in the future. I would definitely take notes and remember everything the techs give you, because lots of techs gave me advice, and even if it's something small, like to remember to put their feet in for a exam of their pelvis, I might kind of forget that small detail, but that really comes back to bite you, because you got to remember all these little details for every exam. So just pay attention and take notes.
Hey there everyone, student producer Elias Bailey here with another Hidden Gem KE. This 74-foot tall lighthouse on Wall Avenue along the lakeside has been part of Milwaukee since 1855. The original lighthouse was much smaller and closer to the shore until 1887, when the present lighthouse was built in its current location.
The lighthouse and grounds were maintained by lighthouse keepers, and later on, the United States Coast Guard, until October 13, 2003, when the United States Coast Guard handed ownership over to Milwaukee County, making this gem a permanent part of Lake Park.
Between 1836 and 1850, Wisconsin's population increased from a mere 11,000 in 1836 to over 305,000 by 1850, all of this due to immigration.
This lighthouse was the first thing the immigrants saw when they entered the new land they would soon call home. This lighthouse serves as both a beacon of change and a symbol of Milwaukee's upbringing. The lighthouse is open to the public every Saturday and Sunday. Schedule a tour and learn more about what makes this a great gem.
Unfortunately though, that is all the time we have for today. I'm student producer Elias Bailey, and this has been another Hidden Gem KE. I'm gonna keep looking around.
I'm student producer Nick Feeling, and this is another Hidden Gem KE. The Oak Leaf Trail is a hidden gem within Milwaukee's woods.
It all started in 1939 by bike advocate Harold Zip Morgan, who envisioned the first 64 miles of the trail from Milwaukee to Menominee.
It wasn't until 1965 that the Milwaukee County Parks recognized the trail and took it over.
Since then, the trail has expanded to over 125 miles with 7 different lines that connects 19 different municipalities. Today, the trail gives residents a place to escape into nature as well as a safe place to exercise.
I'm student producer Nick Feeling, and this has been your Hidden Gem KE.
Hey guys, I'm student producer Ashley Greenwald, and this is another Hidden Gem KE.
Do you know which two major American motorcycling manufacturers that survived the Great Depression?
The two companies were Indian and Milwaukee's own Harley-Davidson. Here at the Harley-Davidson Museum displays Harley's oldest bike in existence, serial number one. In 1903, 21-year-old William S. Harley drew up blueprints of a motorbike engine. He collaborated with childhood friend Arthur Davidson to create the first Harley bike. This is a replica of the original Harley-Davidson shed where the company first started. That bike was built in a factory that was just a 10 by 15 foot wooden shed. Arthur even etched into the door Harley-Davidson Motor Company to make it a little bit more professional. By 1920, Harley was the largest motorbike manufacturer in the world. Well, unfortunately, that's all the time we have left. I'm student producer Ashley Greenwald, and this has been your Hidden Gem KE. This is so cool.
Hello, welcome to Back to the Basics. I'm your host, Seth Wasserman. In this episode, we'll be taking a look behind the scenes in an actual restaurant kitchen. Additionally, we'll show you an amazing recipe you'll want to write down. So sit down, tune in, and check this out. Today, we're going to be making a delicious creamy pasta with chicken. And we're going to heat olive oil over a medium heat. We're gonna get nice and coated. But first, let's take a look inside what goes on behind these restaurant doors.
I mean, we were doing really well. We've been open here about 4 years, and you know, both our restaurants are doing really well, and then drop of a hat, you know, we switched, and luckily we got ahead of the curve with doing to-go stuff. So pretty much, you know, the pandemic and everybody said shut down on Sunday, but at Friday we were open, flip menu, everything like that, just doing to-goes, and that was good. I mean, the community's been great, you know, the supporters of both of our restaurants coming out, and you know, but it's not enough, you know. I mean, people need to still keep coming out, and you know, we appreciate everybody that has, for sure, but yeah, it's been tough, you know. Focusing on you know, good food obviously is the start of it, but then I think the whole experience, you know, is what sets us apart from everybody else. Whether it's like the ambiance of the restaurant, I mean, our servers, our bartenders are fantastic, and like really driving steps of service and making you feel like when you come in here, it's not just for, you know, good food and a good cocktail, it's the best food, the best cocktail, and the best service, the best experience. You know, I think that's what really, really drives us. Special occasions, obviously, you know, anything like that. So I just have to deal with the restaurant day-to-day basis. So I'm in here between, you know, 9, 10 o'clock every day. Start the prep list for the guys, butchering, all that kind of stuff, ordering everything, you know, once a month, doing inventory, stuff like that. And then the guys will get in about, you know, between like 1 and 2, start working on their stations. You know, we'll kind of have a little pre-shift in the kitchen, talk about how the night looks, how the week looks, any projects I need them to do. You know, and what I try to do on a daily basis is involve them as much as I can. So if somebody has an idea, you know, it could be the smallest idea of, hey, I want to run a lamb dish today or tomorrow, like, how can we do it? And then we all get together collectively, and, you know, I just think it helps keep the kitchen involved, keep the guys engaged, you know, and you know, it's part of my job to drive their careers. If they want to be chefs someday, you know, that's part of my job every single day, is to help them get to that. So that's a big part of every single day of my job. I mean, as far as transitioning from style to style, I think that's one thing that keeps, you know, cooks and chefs engaged, right, is if you're doing the same thing over and over and over, it can get a little stale, get a little boring. And, you know, again, like involving these guys with specials and stuff keeps them engaged. But yeah, when you go from restaurant to restaurant, you know, I mean, we're, you know, if you're, you know, primarily a seafood restaurant, and then you go somewhere, I mean, because a lot of these guys too, you know, they have two jobs. So they're working in the morning, maybe at a burger joint, you know, flipping burgers, making soups all day, and then they go cook steaks, you know, or seafood at night, you know? And I think it's difficult at first, I think, but again, you know, that's something that keeps cooks engaged and wanting to bounce around more, you know, until they find the thing that they're like, okay, you know, this is what I love doing. I love doing steaks. I want to do steaks. I want to do this for, you know, forever, you know?
Thanks, Mike, for giving us a little insight into what a typical day for a restaurant worker looks like. Now, let's get going on that pasta dish. First off, we're gonna tenderize this chicken. So we're gonna get some gloves because that's sanitation and that's how we roll around here. So, we're gonna have our chicken breasts here. You can do chicken thighs, you can do chicken breasts, you can do chicken tenders, whatever you could ever imagine. So take our chicken breasts here. We're gonna put it on this already saran wrap, and we are going to take a piece here and we're going to cut it and put it over it so we can tenderize it. So put it over there. Let's give it a nice little cut. Yeah, there he is. So we got our tenderizer here. We're gonna take the flat part first because we wanna make it even. So we're gonna take it here, start at the top, give us some pounds. And then we're gonna give it a little bit of that, a little bit of the tenderizer action. We're gonna flip it over as well, because that's the right thing to do. Now once it's nice and flat, we are gonna season this chicken up. Now what are we gonna season it with, you ask? Well, the classic S&P, and we're also going to use garlic powder. So start off with the salt, get a little high, because you want it to be, you know, covering the chicken. And the higher you go, the more area you cover, right? So that's what we're gonna do. And then we're gonna do garlic powder. It's right here. We're gonna go, oh yeah, garlic powder. And then again, we're gonna flip this guy over. And we're gonna do salt, and we're gonna do pepper. And you can add other spices to this if you want, you know? This has gotta go to the basics, can be whatever you want. You know, we're using paprika later. Use oregano, because this is an Italian dish. So, we're gonna add our chicken to this already hot oil, and we're gonna sear it serving side down, because that's what I was always taught, and that's what I do. So. Here we have our chicken breasts, and now we're gonna take the oil, give it a nice sear. We're gonna let that hang out here. Now, this time, we're going to add our pasta into our water. Now this is penne, and the penne is gonna go into this hot boiling water for 8 to 12 minutes, depending on size, and we're gonna keep this top off, leave it right here. Now, you can use any kind of pasta for this dish. You can use rigatoni, you could use fettuccine, you could use spaghetti for all, you know, whatever you'd like. You could also do, you know, homemade pasta. And you can do, you know, it's a little egg, flour, water, pretty simple stuff. And then you can roll it out, make whatever size and thickness you want. So we're gonna let this sit here. And we are gonna get rid of this plate here because it ain't for us anymore. So, as this chicken's going, and as that pasta is boiling, we are going to do a couple different things. We are gonna take these tomatoes, and we are gonna cut them up. Now, these are sun-dried tomatoes. And people, you know, you can keep them whole. They come, you know, big, small, but we're gonna dice these up real nice. And we're gonna keep a little bit just so we have some garnish for later. So we're just gonna give this a little nice little chop up here. And then we're gonna add them back. So. And then we're gonna put them back into our little bowl here. Because we want to use the big chunks for garnish and the little chunks for flavor. So everything's all back together. And we're also gonna do the same with the parsley because we're gonna put a little bit of parsley in the sauce, and we're gonna put a little parsley on top. So take some of this out of here, and it's okay. Like a lot of people say, you know, don't use the stems, but what I basically do is I just kind of cut off the top and I just don't cut the stems off. And a lot of people say this about all the herbs, but with cilantro, which we're not using right now at the moment, you can absolutely use the whole entire thing. And I think that's a cool fact. So don't forget that. So we are going to take this parsley, chop it up, and save it for later. Let's take a gander of this chicken, make sure it's rocking, looking all right. Turn it up a little bit. I'm just gonna take this fork here and see what the sear looks like. So that's not quite ready to sear yet. We're gonna let that hang out. So while I put this down over here, I'm just gonna move it. We can talk about chicken safety. Chicken is dangerous. If you eat chicken raw, you're gonna get sick. So always use gloves. And always be careful that if you touch raw chicken to your surfaces, you're gonna clean it up because you don't want anything else touching your raw chicken. And that's why we use the saran wrap in the first place. So we are gonna let this go. We're gonna let that go. And we are going to do something that I didn't think we were gonna do, which is also chop up a little bit of the spinach. So, and again, this reason is just to make the pasta look a little bit more green. The sauce, it's for the sauce. It's all about the sauce. So we're just gonna take this, and you can do whatever you want with this. And just make it into nice strips. You can chiffonade this, or you can do whatever you'd like, but we're just gonna make it, we're just gonna cut it up. So chicken seems to be going, searing up real nicely, and get rid of that stem. We are gonna take a look again here again. See what we got going on here. And it's about time to flip. So, this is a little bit of chicken, you know, thicker chicken breast. So this takes anywhere from about, I'd say the golden rule would be like 4 to 8 minutes to each side, but it's really about, you know, if it's actually done. So we are going to let this keep going. And we want to get a deep sear in there. We want to get these herbs and spices, you know, embedded into the chicken breast so it, you know, it tastes good. We let it sit and rest. So there's also a different thing we can do is talk about oil. And oil, you don't always have, you use olive oil today. It's a healthier choice, but there's other oils out there. I personally like to use grapeseed oil. That's just my oil of choice. But there's avocado, there's sunflower, there's vegetable, there's canola. And these are all good options. But it's really up to preference. You know, they all have different smoking points. Olive oil definitely has the lowest smoking point. So it's more likely to burn. And that's why we're doing this low and slow and keeping it going. What I like to do with pasta normally is I like to marinate the meat that I got going on with the pasta with some sort of thing that, you know, would contribute to the dish later today. So like what I would do is I would take the spinach, parsley, maybe some basil, thyme, and I would blend it up and I would marinate it in oil overnight. You don't have to do that. You can just do this really quickly and use dried spices. So here we have prepped garlic and we have this Italian seasoning, which is made up of basil, thyme, rosemary, and oregano. You can use fresh ones, ingredients as well. That's really what I would do as normally, but for this sake and this dish, it is nice to have this stuff already prepared because it does take a whole bunch of time to chop it. Look how fine it is. Do you really want to take all your time and chop up thyme? You know what I'm saying? Just kidding. So what is gonna happen next is we're gonna keep this going, but we're gonna start the sauce. I got this. And so basically, the way that this goes down, we're gonna start heating this pan. But while we're doing that, we're gonna stir these noodles and make sure that they're going. You know, make sure they're cooking. Give it a little heat, make sure that these guys are all ready to go when we're ready to go. Basically, the goal of this is to make everything done at the same time. We want the chicken to be rested, done. We want the pasta to be done because we don't want anything sitting around. We want to serve it hot and we want it to be good. So while this is going, we're going to add some butter, one chunk of butter. This is about a tablespoon. So we're going to do that. We're going to throw this in here and let it melt. And I'm going to take the spoon here and not this plastic so it doesn't melt, because that happens. And you would be shocked how often it does. So we're gonna get this butter going. We're gonna get the bottom coated, and then we're gonna add our garlic. So today we're using pre-cut garlic. And there's a couple different ways you can do it. There's, you know, you can take whole garlic cloves and confit them, just cook them in oil. Cook garlic in oil is basically making garlic confit. So you can do that, or you can do, you know, fresh garlic, slice it up real thin, fry them up, make them crispy. That's a really nice, way to eat it. It gives it a little crunch. So we're gonna add the garlic now while this butter still melts. And the reason we're adding the garlic now is because it also, both of these ingredients burn quickly. And that is something that we don't want. So we're gonna take, we're gonna keep an eye on this. We're gonna keep going over here. And we're gonna keep going. We're gonna let this melt and let it sit. We're gonna let this garlic cook for just a little bit until it gets aromatic. You know, we wanna smell it. You know, because like I said, it burns. Once you get that smell, it's ready to go. Like, there's no doubt in my mind that this is gonna be cooking. So we're gonna hang out here for a sec, and then this pasta should be getting done here pretty soon here. We're just going to give it a little stir. We're going to double check this chicken real quick and see where we're at with that. And we're going to flip that one more time. Oh, now we got all these garlic, salt, and pepper crusted. That's what we're looking for, a nice crust. It's a little dark today, but, you know, it will change with whatever you're using. So we're going to let that sit for just a few more minutes. And in here, while this is going, we're going to make sure it's all even, spread it out, and we are going to add our sun-dried tomatoes. Now, the acidity from these tomatoes, will shock this garlic. So the moment that it goes in, this garlic is gonna stop cooking where it's at. And like I said, we're just gonna take these little guys, throw them in here, just like that. They're soaked in oil, so you can, you know, kind of go heavy on them. You know, just adds more fat to it. It's gonna be really nice. And while that's going on, we're gonna cut this heat. And we are gonna take this chicken right off, and we're gonna let it rest. Just like that. So while that's in there, we're gonna let this sauce keep going. We're gonna keep going around. Get that nice, smells good right here. Oh yeah. So The reason we add tomatoes is because it's a really nice balance between sweet and savory. And, you know, like I said, you can use any kind of tomatoes. Beefsteak, cherry tomatoes. You could do Romas. I tend to use Romas a lot in things. They're very nice, they're soft. Sun-dried gives it a nice little kick to it. And the nice thing about the sun-dried tomatoes is that they don't carry that much water. They are sun-dried compared to all the other tomatoes, which carry a ton of water and which will lead to more leakiness in here. And we don't want that. We don't want watery, you know, pasta. This is a creamy pasta dish. So that's going now. We're gonna add all of our good ingredients. So we got red pepper flakes, more garlic powder, because that's the theme of today, garlic powder, and paprika. And of course, I can't forget my S&P. So I would always put in, depending on how spicy you like it, you know, you can add as much as you want. I kind of like some heat, so I'm gonna add a little bit extra red pepper. I'm gonna add this paprika. Let's give it a little nice, a little oil. We're gonna go, obviously, some more garlic powder. And then the Italian seasoning, we could never go wrong. And then we're gonna weigh in the salt and pepper until we add the cream. So we're just gonna mix this around, just like this. Give it a go, make sure that those spices are just getting nice and cooked up. So from here, we're gonna add a little bit more butter, and that's because it's getting a little dry in here. So we're gonna take this butter, we're gonna let that melt right in the middle here. Now, we are gonna add a bunch of spinach here. And we wanna cover the spinach, this glorious green, beautiful spinach, into this mountain of dairy that was provided by our beautiful state, the Dairyland, or the Dairy State, I should say, because I said state. And we're just gonna mix this up. And cover it all in butter and garlic, and we're gonna make sure that this is all covered so it wilts. We don't want it to get super wilty, because then it gets soggy. And just like any other vegetable, spinach gets filled with water. So that looks like pretty good to me. Get some nice color on it. And now, where we stand today, at this very moment, we are going to add heavy cream. Slowly, but surely. So the heavy cream and the butter are gonna make a nice creamy texture. But while we do this, we're also gonna add this beautiful, beautiful cheese. And the cheese is nice, so, because it actually binds everything together. So we just wanna make sure that this is getting reduced a little bit. So we're gonna give that just a sec, and we're gonna strain our pasta. And we're gonna take this pot right here, we're just gonna cover it, and we're gonna pour it down the sink. But first, before I do that, I'm just gonna take a little bit of pasta water out, because pasta water is good in case your sauce dries out or it needs a little bit more thickness, because basically what happens is it will help thicken up the dry sauce or give you some more, you know, if it's dry or running, excuse me, if it's running, you're gonna want to use the pasta water to thicken up your sauce. So as this is done, we're gonna add our salt and pepper here, and our cheese, and then, oh yeah. Heavy cheese, people, heavy cheese. This is a creamy dish, you know? Let's get some cheese in here. We're gonna save some for garnish, that's what it's about. So mix that up together. Let that go for a second. And you know, the pasta is gonna help melt this cheese as well, because it's also super hot. So we're just gonna take it and dump it in there. And now we can use our plastic fork, because it's way cooled down now. So we're gonna mix this up. We're gonna mash this up. We're gonna take some of our parsley. We're gonna mix this up in here. And we're gonna take the rest of these tomatoes and literally just dump them in here. Now we have creamy sauce going right now. And now we're gonna plate this guy up. Because it's looking real nice. No pasta water needed. Looking real thick, real nice. Just the way I like it. So, we've got our bowl here. We've got a spoon. We're gonna take this out. We're gonna start pouring some in here. Oh yeah. And now it's garnish time. So, to finish off the dish, I always like, some people add chicken to it prior, but that's just not my, it's not my jam. I like to put it on top, makes it look nice. So we're gonna add a little bit of cheese right on top. We're gonna add that parsley, give it a nice little kick. And then we're gonna cut our chicken right here that's been sitting and resting on a nice little bias here. So it makes it nice and long. Don't worry. So we got chicken on the pasta in a nice circular curved motion. And now you can add a little more stuff. You can add a little bit more of this, a little bit more parsley. You can add some, you know, shift basil. You can do a little bit of spinach. I like that. And then you can use, obviously, one super awesome sprig of parsley. And there you have it. A delicious, perfect, creamy chicken pasta. Unfortunately, that's all the time we have today. And tune in next time for stuffed peppers. And I'm talking stuffed peppers. Thank you for tuning in. I'm Seth Wasserman, and I hope you enjoyed this incredible recipe. And go get creamy with your creamy chicken pasta.